authors, editors, publishers, book cover designers, agents, critics, readers. I am your host, Koral Dasgupta, all set to ask some interesting, straightforward, and fun questions to our guests.
Today, I am talking to Meeta Kapoor, who is an author, CEO of Siyahi, and she has been in the literary arena, an extremely known name in the literary arena for a very long time. Welcome to Book Lounge, Meeta.
Thank you for having me.
So, Meeta, I'll start directly with Siyahi. Starting the first literary agency during the days when the word startup didn't exist, what were your strengths or what were the strengths around you that helped you to set up Siyahi?
This is an interesting journey that I've had. I was already, why Siyahi began was that I was already helping friends who were writing and helping them edit and giving them feedback. And interestingly, I was having lunch with one of the publishers from UK. And he said, you know, what you're doing is what an agent does. And I said, okay, why not? And that's on a whim, literally. One of the factors was that. Secondly, while I was working in this field, I had already come to know a lot of publishers. And I also realized that a lot of good work goes unread because there's lack of time, there's lack of people, a lot of work that needed to get done in the field of translations. I was very interested to see. I knew there's a lot of good work happening in the field of translations in pockets in the country. But someone, a professional agency trying to push cross translations and translations into English and vice versa into our languages, I found that gap. So these were these two, three reasons why Siyahi began. And literally, yes, you're right. The word startup really didn't exist when I began. My strength was that publishers had faith in us. I think I still owe a lot of Siyahi starting to Namita Gokhale. She was probably the first person I had this conversation with. And she said, just go ahead and do it. It's very required. And as and when I kept talking to more and more friends who were either writers or editors or connected with the industry, they all came forward with so much enthusiasm that we just took off from there. You know, it's as simple a story, but if you look at it, there are so many people who have still and still continue to be my pillars, and still continue to have faith.
Absolutely.
And what I had to be was a reader. I had to be a book lover. My concerns for the languages, my desire to really uphold that ideal. And I still work on that. It's a very important and significant part of our mandate when we run Siyahi, is to keep trying to push for cross-translations and also on the global and international platform. So we're continuing on the same path. We're growing organically. We've never had a number game in mind. We've just kind of stumbled our way through, and I think we're still stumbling our way through, frankly.
Number, I don't think you were ever focused on the number in that sense. I mean, you are more focused on the quality than the quantity, right?
Always. I can't. Somebody asks me how many authors you have, and I go completely blank. I still can't answer that question. So my numbers and me have not been friends. That's the woe my husband also has. He says, you know what, you need to deal with them at some stage. And I'm like, no, you bother with that. Let me be on the creative side and let me just carry on being like this. I want to remain in this cocoon. It's more satisfying.
Absolutely. So who were you before Siyahi, if I may ask? Or, I mean, as a teenager, maybe. I mean, what were your dreams then and has it changed?
Oh, yeah, tremendously. And I'm so glad my dreams changed. Some part of me always wanted to write. Some part of me always wanted to champion and be on the side of people who needed to be championed for or who needed standing up for. So when I took to writing as a journalist, I was freelancing. A lot of work was put in from my end for cases for domestic violence, for cases for rape, for cases for girl child education. So I worked a lot with such things while I was writing as a freelancer. I'm still freelancing, but and I wish I could give as much time to these are the things that I really held dearly to myself. So that's what I took off on before I started CIE.
Okay. And one thing that often crossed my mind but never got a chance to ask you, and I'll ask you right away, why the name Siyahi Mita?
Well, you know something, we were just looking for names to name the literary agency. And we even came up with, well, a very droll sense of humor, me and my bunch of friends and all of us who were putting Siyahi together had. So we even toyed with like rejection note, or not the last word, or, you know, something like that. And then everybody said, you know what, everybody doesn't have your kind of sense of humor. You might just strike the wrong chord. And then this friend of mine and me, who, in fact, he still works with me on Siyahi. I mean, I can't imagine doing stuff without him. So we were sitting, can you believe it, of all the places in Pizza Hut in Ganpati Plaza in Jaipur, and pulling names down, and he was the one who came up with the word Siyahi. And I just looked at him. I said, okay, done. Stop now.
Okay. So it was not something that you had put in the initials of names or something like that. It was just a beautiful name that you wanted to put together.
It says ink, right?
Right. Right.
And what more?
It's absolutely
great connect.
Yeah.
It's most apt. So Siyahi came about.
Intellectually and creatively, it's probably just merged together.
Yeah.
Okay, so you were just talking about a friend who had been a very strong pillar to Siyahi. Who were the people who stood beside you in your single-handed mission to set up Siyahi? Who, I mean, tell me about,
one,
I don't know whether I should call them the team.
Never
but
a mission for me. Two, I think I'll take half an hour to recount a list of names put by us. So in all, I've already taken Namita's name. There's Pramod Kumar, who runs Eka Archiving right now. He's one of the finest museum curators we have in the country. He's been there. A lot of other people from the publishing industry have been there. I mean, with the publishing industry, I'll have to take a long time to
actually pick out each other's
name. Yes, yeah. And the person who helped me name Siyahi was Mihir. My husband's been a huge support. So he used to be my bouncing pad for everything. And there are so many other close friends, and it's just been such a lot of teamwork. Everyone's contributed, I think, so many people. And all my authors, I mean, come on. I can't even think of Siyahi existing without the existence of these people who have reposed their faith in Siyahi. Trusted us with their creativity, with their work, with their blood and sweat, because that's what it takes to write. And I think that's, they are the biggest pillars that I have. All of them. From the start of 2007.
I was just going through Siyahi website, and the authors that you have worked with are huge. What is the value addition that you have done in their lives other than bringing the publisher and the author together? I mean, I'm sure there's a lot more that you have done than simply putting it like that.
I think you should ask them that question, no?
What is your vision, Mita?
well, because, see, for us, when we strategize the publishing of a particular book for any author who has signed up with us, we look at the larger picture always. It's not the future of that one book. I always look at a larger literary career. I always tell them that we have to keep the vision that we have for you in mind. And for every author, the vision obviously varies. So for me, it's never the financial factor which comes into play. That's the last thing that comes into play. I literally handhold every author right from the first step till the last. So for me, the process doesn't get over ki haan, aaj contract sign ho gaya hai. Or Mm-hmm. You deal with the we are there at every step of the way, where it right till the end, where it comes to even keeping track of royalty statements. It comes to keeping track of how the book is being promoted. It comes to keeping track for obviously submitting the book for other translations into other languages. Mm-hmm. Again, it varies from case to case, from book to book, right? So we treat each book as a special project.
Mm-hmm.
There is no generalization that's done at our end.
Mm-hmm.
Because every book you open opens another new world to you.
Absolutely.
So you treat that book according to the world it gives you, right?
Absolutely.
So that's the kind of value addition I bring to every author, at least I hope so.
Mm-hmm.
And we brainstorm, we argue, we discuss everything, even book jackets for that. Even sending their names to literary festivals that they should get invited to. Doing social media for them, to making sure that their editing goes on smoothly and there are no hurdles. So we step in at every point. So for me, it's a journey that never is, it's not supposed to get over, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
And touch wood, hasn't happened.
Absolutely. Meeta, the times that you were talking about, there was nothing like for today, every startup, they have a lot of opportunities to go and seek funding. You didn't belong to that time. Siyahi, when it started, it didn't belong to that time. I'm sure there must have been a lot of hurdles that you have faced in putting the bricks together and making sure that you are able to run it the way you wanted. And you probably didn't make the kind of compromises that people usually make when there are some hard times. How did you manage that?
See, I won't say that there were hurdles, yes. One, I was, I really want to look at it positively and say that my family was with me.
Okay.
That's very important. I did not take a penny from anyone. I actually built CIE from my own, so to say, pocket money, from whatever. And I put in very little money because I had none, frankly. So that's how I managed to build slowly, 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 slowly. And obviously, yeah, there was no question of a venture capital or no question of me seeking a loan from a bank. Or I just started on my soft skills. My soft skills were my strength. And luckily, my team that came together. See, we what you need is being mad and passionate about something you want to do. I think I was blessed because I found, as I stumbled across on this path, I found a lot of people who came together as my team who were probably even more insane than I was. And that's how we kind of managed to just carry on year after year after year. I mean, I still remember the joy of... So the first year, I didn't even have a catalog to show to people, right? I just had maybe four or five authors. But the next, second year, we printed our own CIE catalog. Now you can, I cannot forget that day when I held that printed catalog in my hand. And then the second year, I went to Frankfurt with that catalog.
Okay.
So, and but yeah, I went to Frankfurt with obviously my personal, on my personal expense.
Absolutely.
There was no money in CIE. But I said, you know what? Okay, let's take it as an investment and move ahead. And it's been tough to break into the international market, but we managed. The secret is to just keep at it.
So, you have seen the times when authoring was a very niche segment, and these are the times when books have a retail market. How do you look at this scenario as a book lover and as a veteran in book business?
One, I don't think I'll ever be a veteran because I'm still a learner. I learn every day, and I'm constantly being challenged every day. Yeah, it wasn't exactly that niche, frankly speaking. The books were out in the retail very happily. It was a growing segment then also, and it's still growing. Yes, the consciousness that your book can be marketed as a product, can be it's out and it has to be consumed and not just read, is the new tangent that has come in. But pretty much was a very exciting time then. It's a very exciting time now. And with technology, things changed. And you're dealing with, you grow with that. You use it to your advantage.
Okay, so today the options are far more. So do you think India's literary culture, I mean, this time I'm talking about not just books, but as a culture, the entire scenario. So do you think India's literary culture is changing more with more and more publishing houses, more authors, more literary agents, more litfests, and there are so many more publishing options. Do you think the entire culture is going through some kind of evolution?
Evolution, definitely, yes. I think, and that's very good because the industry has to be constantly morphing. It has to constantly grow and or adapt or metamorph into its different roles, different avenues. I think it's very important. Yes, we have gone through a lot of changes in the Indian literary scene as well. Many more publishers have entered the game. The kind of content that they are putting out has changed a lot. So if you see, there are different genres being experimented with. And most of them, some of them are doing really well. So there's a lot more open-mindedness. There's a lot more investment into the marketing of these new genres. There's a lot more technology that's available. So you've got, like, come on, you guys are doing a podcast right now.
Absolutely, so, from two different locations.
So authors are using podcasts to promote themselves or to put out chapters or read them out, or the spoken word is becoming another new genre which is becoming so big right now. A lot more festivals are thriving, which is great because regionally authors from that particular region get encouraged and you create new readerships, which is again very important. So all in all, I think we are in a fantastic space.
Great. Mita, my last question, and this is more of a leadership question than a publishing question. Do you have a salaried employee in CIAHI today? And the reason why I ask this is that when a person is salaried, that person comes from an outer universe. So how do you select that person and figure that that person can fit into your vision and understand where you are taking?
I have salaried employees in my organization. We are, apart from me, there are five other people who are working. And from time to time, I bring in consultants as well, especially when we are doing our festivals. And the selection of such people is, it's the normal. We let the word out that we are hiring for so and so post, and people apply and come in for interviews. And obviously, I'm very fussy. I'm very anal. So I look for that streak of, you know, that little spark that that person who's applying or who's giving an interview in my office is actually, you know, he or she may not be trained as an editor. I'm okay with making them learn hands-on in my office. I just need a certain madness and commitment from that person. You know, that willingness to learn, to experiment, to put forward, to take the initiative, have that kind of drive, be on the roll. And yes, two very important things that really, really work as qualification for me is deliver on deadline and my quality. These two things, I'm known to have thrown people out because if they've lacked on this, then they're shown the door. But I mean, outside perspective, and I like working with younger people. I'm the oldest in my team. They're all probably half my age or less than half my age. So that's what I like to keep it at.
Superb. Mita, thank you so much for taking out time and talking to us. It really means a lot, and I had a great time talking to you.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you reaching out to me. Thank you.
Totally my pleasure. Thank you so much.